Hello and welcome to the online service of Nambour Anglican Parish. Through this online service, we pray you find encouragement in your walk with God. May God bless you today as you join your spirit with God's spirit in worship and fellowship.
Well, I'm coming from a different angle this morning, so I ask you to indulge me. There's something about us humans that loves surprises. Good surprises, that is. The awkward, unpleasant surprises we dismiss as an ambush. But that's life. Someone once said to me, rather wistfully, that he now misses seeing the joy on littlies' faces as they open their Christmas or birthday presents. Many of us have seen the astonishment, the simple pleasure at the gift. And though the little one may not yet be able to put it into words, other than thank you, Grandpa, or whatever, for the gift, the response itself can be worth the giver's labour of decision-making, obtaining, wrapping, then being there at the opening. In many respects, it's the same with Easter. It is God's gift to us. Just as the conception and birth of his only Son is God's gift to us. Just as the whole calling of Abraham and the history of God's self-revealing through Abraham's descendants via the covenant God made with him. All God's gifts. Because Jesus is the Word perfectly enfleshed amongst us and steadfastly faithful even to the cost of his earthly life. But his early followers were at a loss to know how to deal with his execution. But we know now, we know how the story develops in terms of events. It's Paul, the one-time persecutor of Christians, who was personally ambushed by Jesus and became a Christian himself. And he, with other early Christian writers of our New Testament scriptures, help us make sense in an earthly sense, the earthly sense we can make of the extraordinarily great gift that God has given us. Not only through Israel's religious faith, but in the person, example, and teaching of Jesus. Now, I would have extended the reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 15 a little more, because in the next few verses, Paul says, if Christ had not been raised, your faith is futile, and we are still in our sins. Well, he says, you are still in your sins, but we would still be in our sins. Now, we Christians do tend to go on about sin. But the stakes are higher than sin and forgiveness. What we are dealing with in Jesus' resurrection is that there is more to life than the everyday pressures and anxieties and struggles and failures that we know so well. It's a matter of going beyond the everyday and our circumstantial concerns, even though they are indeed vital to our everyday quality of life, but not life itself. It's the gift of perspective that matters. There's more to every day than the day itself. And while our everyday society caters for the needs it has power to meet, like food, housing, transport, etc., it has absolutely no leverage whatever on life, life itself. For the gift of actual life is God's, and exclusively God's to give. Now, as we approach this Jesus-given sacrament of Holy Communion, I will invite you with an ancient phrase, lift up your hearts, to which we respond, we lift them to the Lord. That's familiar to us, right? What's going on? What's this really about? It's not only about remembering in our hearts and minds and everyday discipleship that Jesus' unswerving faithfulness to the Father has opened the way for our own salvation, nor is it simply a memorial reenactment of the Last Supper to remind us of what our salvation cost Jesus in his own historic humanity. St. Paul gives us a hint also in that same chapter of this morning's letter. It's 1 Corinthians 15. It's well worth a read from your home Bible. This is what he wrote to the people in Corinth. I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And Paul continues, for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. That's the clincher. That's the frame, if you like, of what we do this morning and in every Eucharist. I have celebrated Eucharist at deathbeds, Eucharist in a vast, elegant cathedral with a throng gathered, when the Archbishop or Bishop is the president. And it's just a lovely occasion where you sense the enormous diversity and humanity and complexity of the church. But it's more than a memorial meal. It's a heavenly banquet to which we are invited only because Jesus' human, unswerving faithfulness unto death has been answered by God's vindication, which Easter Day was God's perfect vindication of the humanity of the Son, and followed by, Jesus appeared to his disciples, and then some 40 days later, after his resurrection, he ascended into heaven, which is his true home and our true destiny, where he now sits at God's right hand until God's perfect kingdom dawns, comes into its fullness in heaven, and all creation finds its true eternal life. So lift up your hearts is a rich, rich command, because we're not just looking back, we're not just remembering, we're in the grand scheme of God's eternity, God's love, God's grace. What was embodied in Jesus, what he did for our salvation, and the doors he has opened for us. And in our Lord's Prayer, we pray, Father, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. So here we are strengthened to do our bit for the coming of the kingdom and to hold on to the resurrection, no matter what it cost, no matter what our discipleship cost in the everyday. So I did prepare some homework, which is what I laughingly call it. And one of my parishioners in Coolum at one stage said, Jim, what happened to you this morning? I said, what do you mean? He said, you didn't give us any homework. There's a portion of Psalm 63. Some of you will have Bibles at home. Psalm 63 is one that I use often. I love it. And it's about hungering and thirsting for God. So we'll see how things go. I'm not sure what we're up to in the copies being available at the back. But if you have a psalm at if you have a Bible at home, just note Psalm 63 verses 1 to 6 in particular, or a prayer book at home, Psalm 63 verses 1 to 6. So that's the deal. May it take root deep within you, and may you know the joy of the risen Christ every day, and the hope in which we live. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
May the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you what is pleasing in his sight. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace, filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. In the name of Christ. Amen.
Thank you for watching today. We hope it has been an encouragement to you for your spiritual life. Please subscribe to this channel. Also, if you would like to support us financially, you can click the link in the description below. Thank you for joining us. God bless.